السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers and sisters, we continue today our talk about the civil liberties, and we started with the freedom of conscience. Of my reading and of my analysis, I see what distinguishes the West which apply all these moral values, all these Islamic values we mentioned in 29 days of Ramadan, from the rest of the world, that they believe in these principles and they apply it in their life, in their universities, in their courts, on the ground. It's unfortunate that the rest of the world, they have these values more or less in their books, in their constitutions, but in reality, they don't apply it. So there's discrepancy. They fall under the definition of the hypocrite. They say something and they do something. The poets one time said, "Kullun yadda'i hubban bi layla wa layla la tuqirru lahum bi dhaka." So this basic matrix of society, which we call it the civil liberties, used to be called God laws, or the natural laws, and evolved in the last 2-3 centuries into the rights of man, or human rights. And this is what we find nowadays in the Charter of the United Nations in 1948 and on. And this, here in the West, here in the States, we call them civil liberties. They are the personal guarantees and freedoms governments cannot take away, cannot abridge by any means, even the law and judicial interpretations. Of these are the right of life, freedom from torture and death, and integrity of the self, self-defense, privacy, the rights to liberty and property and equality of conditions, equality in front of the law, and fair trials, the freedom of conscience and thought and religion, the freedom of speech and expression and the press, the freedom of the association and assembly and voting and establishment of civil association and political associations. Those you find them in the Constitution in the United States, you find them in the Bill of Rights. And those are the cornerstones of the Western civilization. I know to some extent in Europe, Scandinavia, all this democratic world, you find all these principles more or less. And our talk is about the conscience and the freedom of conscience and the freedom of thought, as sometimes it's expressed. And here what we are going to dwell on, the conscious conscience, because everyone has a conscience. Some of our consciences are strangulated or hidden or oppressed, and others the conscience is clear and on the surface and it's obvious, and it's awake and it's functioning. And this is what the conscience. And we said the conscience, philosophers, has books and tons of articles about it. It's the God sparkle within us. It's the inner voice. It's the inner light. It's the guidance to us from righteousness or the right action, from the wrong actions, and in one's behavior. Many, many books in literature and other arts has been dwelling on this issue of conscious and the conscious conscience. And all the way to the Disney movies, and we find an example of it, Jimmy the Cricket in Pinocchio. He is the sound or the conscience of that wooden boy. And he has a beautiful song which says, "Let your conscience be your guide." So conscience is the matrix, indispensable condition of nearly every other form of freedoms. So it's very basic, it's very essential. And conscience is a thought process preceding the action. As a matter of fact, in neuroscience, they were able to determine when that feeling is sparked. And they say it's like 300 milliseconds before the action takes place, where the conscience give a judgment. When somebody, let's say, want to commit something bad, slap somebody, hear the conscience, 300 milliseconds is sparked, that's wrong, you know. And usually the conscience doesn't tell you what to do right, but it awares you that this is wrong and cannot be done. This voice is infallible, it's innate moral core in human nature. And the question comes now, is this conscience absolute or it is relative? Relative to individuals, societies, communities, nations. From all the evidence that it is relative. What's make right and wrong in this culture, it's completely different from other cultures. We have many examples, things you don't feel comfortable to do, like, you know, let's say greeting by hugging a stranger, especially if it's a woman. I mean, in many cultures, that's acceptable. Here in the West, it's acceptable. But in our culture, we don't feel comfortable to touch a woman who is not mahram. So here you see the relativism. Also, at the level of nations, why all those wars, which has been fought by clear conscience? All the killing of millions and millions. Of course, every side of the story who tells you, I'm doing this with deep conviction that this is right and my conscience is clear. So you see here that things are relative. And has to do with the level of awareness and awakening of this conscience. Because the greatest enemy of the conscience, which should be absolute, it should be on the fourth dimension of morals and values. It should be God's view of the whole world, not relative. The opposite and enemy of conscience is greed and selfishness and all these material things which can strangulate the conscience. But it let it act at level of family, where you find the person is more conscious towards his family, his wife, his children, but he is pugnacious and obnoxious towards his neighbor or out in the society, and so on to the countries and nations. So this level of awakening and clearance of the conscience and awakening of the conscience to the level of the fourth dimension is the mission of Islam. As a matter of fact, and I will talk about this, I see if you want to translate Islam in other world current nowadays, it is a process or the whole thing is awakening the conscience, absolute awakening to the conscience, to look at humanity and our actions in God's viewpoint, absolute truth. So Islam succeeded in doing this by awakening the conscience from an-nafs al-ammara bis-su', the pugnacious self, the greedy, selfish self, the self which sees nothing but its own interest, regardless, ready to step on anyone else, including sometimes family and children and wives. This self, al-ammara bis-su', through the process of tazkiyah, and this is one of the missions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As we know from four ayahs describe the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَالَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Yuzakkihim is to awaken their conscience, bring in that voice of God which is inside every self, وَنَفَخْنَا فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِنَا, to the surface, to be in charge of all our actions indeed. And this will lift the person to the level of an-nafs al-lawwama, which at the end of the day tells you what you have done, right and wrong, and make you feel uncomfortable and fix the wrong thing. And by this training, you will reach the level of an-nafs al-mutma'inna, which is in complete charge of yourself, no place for selfishness or pugnacity or obnoxiousness or transgression or greed or injuring anyone else. And this is the goal of the tazkiyah. I was watching one of Disney movies with my grandchild, the Fox and the Hound, and that hunter there, it's example of the obnoxious, heartless person who knows nothing but his gun and shooting foxes and selling their skin in the market. That's all his life. But long story, but beautiful story. At the end, we see how his dog, through the fox, taught him a lesson for him that there's other considerations in life. One of it is friendship. That hound, that fox and the hunting dog, when they were little and they played together and had fun, they vowed to be friends forever. And beautiful, you can see it on YouTube when he tells them, "You're my friend forever." Copper is the dog, and Todd is the fox. But they grow up, and the fox has a job in life, and the dog has a job in life, and those crossed that friendship. But at any rate, when that fox saved the life of the hunter and the dog at the end from a grizzly bear, here, and he was injured and he was weak, the hunter, by reflexes, he took his gun, wanted to shoot that fox, but here the dog, which was also chasing the fox before, stood in the front of the gun, like telling the hunter, "You cannot hurt him but on my dead body." And here you find the expression of the face of the hunter going through that conscience awakening. Took few minutes for him to realize that there is here some other values competing with your own interest. That fox saved your life and the life of your dog. They were friends. And we know he lowered his gun and he ordered his dog, "Let's go back home," and they let the fox live. This is a way we can teach our children. Stories are very well known, great factor in teaching moral values and these principles. So we mentioned last week that usually the voice of the conscience is a singular voice, stands opposite structure. That structure could be tyranny, of despotic rulers, emperors, kings, you name them. Our history full of those characters. And of course, everyone has his own viewpoint and vantage point. That single voice can be against yourself, can you be against your family, can you be against society, can you be against a city or a village or a culture, can be against the whole empire or kingdom or nation or country. And we have tons of examples of people with a conscious conscience who stood up against themselves or all what I counted. From the beginning of humanity, we know Habil, the son of Adam, his conscience did not allow him to defend himself and kill his brother. When his brother wanted to kill him, the conscience of Cain was asleep, was strangulated, was pushed down with jealousy and hatred, but Habil, told him, if you stretch your arm to kill me, and that's wrong, I will not stretch my arm to kill you. I fear God. And that will lead me, that statement, to know that conscience, in a way, and I might not be 100% true, but right, but it is really something to contemplate. That conscience, the other word for it in Islam, is taqwa. Taqwa is the ultimate conscience, critical conscience, the fear of God and the principles which pleases God. We know in the story of Noah, how here his conscience did not let his son drown, and he begged him to come on the ship. And the son saw a big mountain, and he said, well, that mountain will protect me. But it did not help. We know that this conscience of Ibrahim, alayhi salam, worked against his father and his community when he challenged them about the idols which they are making, including his father and uncle. They say they were in the business of making idols, sculpturing idols, and they punished him by hellfire. Also, Ibrahim alayhi salam is an example of facing the tyranny of the dictator, the Namrud. He stood up to him and challenged him about his belief system. When he told him, I can kill and keep alive, he told him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring the sun from the east, bring it from the west, and then he was shocked, the Namrud, and he knew that he is nothing. Lut alayhi salam, the nephew of Ibrahim alayhi salam, his conscience stood up to the whole city, or two cities if you want, Sodom and Gomorrah, and even against him was his wife. So Lut alayhi salam prevailed and left safely. Musa alayhi salam, with his clear conscience and his brother Harun, they stood up to Pharaoh with all his tyranny. And we know the story. Isa alayhi salam, he stood up against the whole Roman Empire. And he was brought to the court of Pontius Pilate, and we know the story of his in the court and what happened. Of course, we Muslims, we have different end of the story than the Christian end of crucifixion. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his conscience, he stood up not against the tyranny of Quraysh, but against the tyranny of all establishment in the whole world. From day number one, where he wanted to lift humanity to the fourth dimension of morality and values. When he, from the first day in the Quran, as we read, ordering him to tell humanity, Inni Rasulullahi ilaykum jami'a. He transcend Quraysh and his society to all mankind. We see it from the first verse, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So it's a universal message to lift humanity up beyond individual or family or society or country or nations or empires to a level of humanity and lift them up to have a world consciousness, which, thank God, humanity went that route, as we mentioned in the 29 days of that argument, that Islamic values been applied all over the globe, we like it or not, in different names or different things, but the ultimate result is the same. And we see it in United Nations declarations of human rights, and so this is what Islam was looking for, and this is what was preaching in those 1400 years, the world consciousness. That's why nowadays we hear about crimes against humanity. We didn't used to hear these words a few hundred years ago or before the 20th century and so on. You find in Islam those ideas of honesty and trustworthiness, amana, and love of parents and family and so on transcend any other measurement or any other consideration. You have to be honest for everyone, towards everyone. You have to tell the truth about to everyone. The same thing with the amana and trust and justice. All these are not relative. Those are worldly, those are fourth dimension moralities and so on. In the history, we know this tension between the individual and the conscience and the establishment goes all the way back to the Greek mythology and the Greek stories and the Greek tragedies and Sophocles and Aeschylus and Euripides. There are many, many stories. One of them is Antigone. Antigone was a young lady who her brother was considered by the establishment, by King Creon, to be a criminal opposing him. And he was killed, and he punished him by ordering the people not to bury his corpse. And this is in violation of God's commandments to bury the dead. So they have a closure, and his soul go and rest in peace. So Antigone, his sister, defied the king, though she was going to lose her life herself, and buried her brother. Because the human law cannot override God's laws. And that simple story goes all the way nowadays. That's why the Nazi been brought to justice. The law of Hitler and the Nazi, for the people who are executing them, they cannot override God laws of annihilating people, genocide, and all of this. And nowadays, all these courts we hear about in the Netherlands, for the war criminals, war criminals and so on. The argument, they say, well, we are obeying orders. But those orders could not be carried on because those are against God laws or the world consciousness and so on. We find this tension when Socrates was sentenced to death by democracy of Athens. And Socrates has a way to run away. His students, Plato and many of his students, they bribed the guard, they arranged for a route for safety and so on, but he refused. And we read this in Crato, where his argument or his, that what gave him his statue of enjoying liberty and freedom and of consciousness and all of these, were based on the laws, and the law sentenced him to death. So you see, for him to save his life, he's violating the law, and he cannot do that, because there is here contradiction and paradox. So he refused to run away, and that tension between the individual and society was expressed very well in that chapter. We find this argument goes all the way till nowadays. We remember the boxer Muhammad Ali. He faced the same dilemma. His conscience would not allow him to go and kill Vietnamese who he probably does not know where they are on the map. Here, the society, the country, the laws of the country should be defended by soldiers, by the drafted young men to go and fight. So here, the conscience override these laws or this, but at a cost and at a price and at a consequences, defined by the law, which is prison. So he followed his conscience, but he was prisoned. He was put in prison. And this is what the moralists say. Many people, for example, their conscience did not allow, like doctors, I don't believe in abortion, and I cannot be placed in a clinic to perform abortion. I have, my conscience is clear about that, so in this case, my license might be revoked, or I might be fired from my position. So I have to face that consequence. The same thing, many pharmacists, they don't sell birth control pills, especially if they certain religions or sects and so on, or the pill after the heavy dose of estrogen and progesterone, which if there is a fertilized egg happen the night before, definitely it will be wasted. So many pharmacists, they refuse to sell. But when he signed the contract to work for that pharmacy, he knows this is business and they have to provide everything, including liquor and cigarettes. Up till now, I think cigarettes have been removed from the shelves. So his conscience should be clear. If he does not want to do this, he will face consequences to be fired from his job. And we find tons of examples of people who could not tolerate doing things against their conscience, and they changed their jobs. So this tension between the establishment, the laws, the bylaws, by the policy of whatever company or country or and the single conscience of a person, when there is a clash between them, there is an outlet. You follow your conscience and you tolerate the consequences. So in Islam, we know that the conscience, the self, which is awake judging your action and deed, and nafs al-lawwama, the conscience, many ayahs dwell on this in different expression, like قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Anyone who purify himself, his soul, his whatever want to call it, a nafs, and alleviate its level of consciousness about the conscience, you will succeed in life. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. The one who strangulate his conscience or indulge in all these things, he will become more like a beast. We know from another ayah, فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. You see here the word taqwa comes in the sense of conscience, which is awake, which prohibits you from doing wrong thing or evil thing. And we know from one of the hadith, which I don't think it's a strong sanad, the jihad al-nafs, it's the highest level of strive and toil and sacrifice is to try to control your desires and whims and greed and selfishness and purify yourself to higher level and degrees to the an-nafs al-mutma'inna. So we know in Islam if taqwa means consciousness of God, awareness of God, the presence of God, the fear of God, the hope to please God and win his favors and blessing and grace, and the hereafter, the to pass the sirat and to pass the judgment and win his heavens, and ultimately to be exposed to see his face in the wujuhun nazira ila rabbiha nazira. When you want to, you know, do all of this, we know that you are keeping yourself at the higher level of consciousness and awakened conscience. And we know all the ibadat, from salah to zakah to siyam to hajj, the ultimate goal of it is to increase your taqwa, to increase your awareness of God, the presence of God, the consciousness of God, the fear of God, the hope and desire in pleasing God, and be exposed to all these things. So that means the mu'min, the believer, and we know iman can increase and decrease. When you are full of iman, you're walking and you have in the presence of God, you are immersed with God's mercy and love and compassion. So no way for you to commit any atrocity or any wrongdoing or transgress against anyone or do anything immoral. So this is the highest level of a conscience which is awake and conscious, a taqwa. And this is the ultimate goal of our religion. We know it from many, many ayahs. Taqwa. La'allakum tattaqoon. And so on. So all our practices in Islam, ibadat especially, they are designed by God for us to increase our level of taqwa, consciousness of God, being awake and conscientious. To do the right thing and avoid the wrong thing. Of course, to be fair to all these tyrannies and kings and dictators and majority, tyranny of majorities and nations and all these, all of them, they tell you their argument. Those individuals who are creating trouble, and they are called iconoclasts, like prophets. You know, Quraysh was happy, business as usual. Where is this Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes and create, disturb the peace, you see? So those establishment, they are concerned with the peace of the masses and concerned with security, homeland security. They are concerned about business as usual, but with all this accumulation of things in the empires and so on, hide a lot of injustices, unfairness, enslavement. The weak individual is helpless in this huge, big machine. That's true. To have peace is very important, environment to work very important, and so on. But what the benefit of all of this if people are enslaved or crushed or stepped on or lied at or at the mercy of the tyrant or the despotic ruler or the emperor or whoever. Patrick Henry, I mean the colonists, the 13 colonists, they were living good life relatively. They could not tolerate King George III to come and increase their taxes without being represented in the parliament. And we know the story of the independence revolution and the war, and we know Patrick Henry when he screamed with his eloquent way of expressing himself in speech, give me liberty or give me death. So here he was talking about these basic rules. I mean, empire structures, the communist system was big, huge, very well structure, but carry with it a lot of individual abusement and stepping on all these fundamental values, liberty, freedom, equality, and justice, and all of these things. So this tension is very, very prominent among the establishment and the individual. The individuals, as we know, they come to change. And we have, in history, we mentioned many names. And last week we mentioned all the prophets suffered and stood up to the establishment, especially Yahya alayhi salam, John the Baptist. He lost his head because he said his conscience that marriage was illegal. between Herod Antipas, the son of Herod the Great, and his wife, who was apparently, her marriage was not nullified, the previous marriage, and so on. And she was irate, and she asked her daughter Salome to dance and with the price of the head of the prophet Yahya alayhi salam, and he was killed. We have also the story of Isa alayhi salam, which triggered all this massive tsunami or earthquake which covered all Europe and so on with Christianity, based on the injustice been made against Jesus, peace be upon him, and his followers, which historically we know them as the Nazorians. And of course, they were labeled to be troublemakers, and probably if we use nowadays language, we will call them different names, and you know what I mean. Of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also, when he shook the foundation of Quraysh by his message of truth and love and compassion, also suffered a lot, and he prevailed with God's design, and he was like closer to be like Moses, alayhi salam, being a successful prophet and messenger and ruler and leader and teacher and governor and you name it. He was successful in all the, and this is the biggest sign of which in history rarely or probably never happened to any person outside Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's by itself is a testimony for the truth of his message. We know that Al-Husayn alayhi salam, when he stood up to the tyranny of Bani Umayyah and their abuse of power, also shook the foundation of the Muslim world, and the dynasty fell not too long after that incident. Of our scholars, beside the four a'imma, and we have mentioned how much they stood up to the truth, and they've been tortured, and some of them died under torture, also stood up to the truth, single-handedly. And usually this is the price you pay when you are this caliber of people. They don't exist. In 100 years, probably you have one or two. Well, those are personalities, you know, we're scared to be in their shoes, but we admire immensely the prophets and the scholars. We know Sa'id ibn Jubayr was a great scholar. All the ummah were in need to his knowledge. And we know Al-Hajjaj, in the name of peace and security, and Hajjaj was fighting regional wars against Al-Ash'ath and so on, and Sa'id happened to be, you know, opposing the rule, and he eventually was killed. We know that also Adi ibn Hajar was also killed in a similar situation. And there is many, many of those martyrs in our history who stood up to the truth, and they paid their lives as a price. In the West, of course, also there were many people who stood up to the tyranny of the emperors and the rulers and the church. And of course, the viewpoint of the church, they want to keep peace and harmony and universal religion, and anyone who opened his mouth, they would crush him under the title of heretics. And of course, you go to the history books, there's thousands and thousands, literally, of people who are, majority are scholars, but some of them, maybe they are troublemakers, but majority are scholars or scientists who lost their lives. And unfortunately, most of them were killed by burning alive at a stake, and their books been burned with them. Of course, not to mention that over 200,000 of people perished under the accusation being witches. And all the scholars nowadays, they tell us, there wasn't any witching, you know, it was just the way the tyrants would like to tarnish or demonize the opponents by labeling them some bad names. They were economic war. because of the nobility and the feudal system, and now we have industry coming and the women going out to the working force and so on, and here comes this oppression of women under the name of witchcraft. And here in America, thank God didn't happen, probably 19 people being punished or killed in Salem trials, but in Europe it was 200 years of massive killing, which one estimate over 200,000 women perished under the accusation of being witches. We know from the history book that Thomas Becket, who was Archbishop of Canterbury at the time of Henry II, he paid his life, and he was killed by four soldiers in his own church. And later on, he became, of course, the this is the irony that Schopenhauer one time said that any idea is opposed violently first, then fought bravely, then when that idea prevail, become self-evident, even for the tyrants. So they jump on the wagon and they claim the ownership of the idea. So here, most of those victims, they've been made by those who oppressed them, made saints or made martyrs and made figures which everyone revere nowadays, like Thomas Becket. We have Jack de Molay and Geoffrey de Charny. Those were the leaders of the Templars. And the Templar story is very interesting because it continued to nowadays with the Freemason. Those have been opposed by Philip IV. And the Philip IV was the emperor of France and bigger territory. And he was in big financial debt. And those Templars were very, very wealthy with land and artifact and other treasures, and came an idea from advisor. So it was political war against them, where he overnight attacked the Templars everywhere in Europe, and they've been butchered, literally, and those two leaders were burned alive. And the accusations were that they are followers of Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Templar originated at the time of Crusaders, and the accusation was they were influenced by Islam, and they were worshiping Muslim ideas and so on. This is one of the accusations. So you need accusation to dehumanize or to find legitimate reason to abuse or do bad things to them. Many, many great scholars like John Huss, William Tyndale, who is the first one who translated the Bible to English, the current English language, before King James and so, all of them, they based their great masterpieces on William Tyndale. He was burned alive. Also, Bruno, one of the great brains of astronomy and so on, he was burned alive. All these accusations are that they are heretics. But nowadays, we know their ideas were right, and those who killed them were just establishment which is felt they are threatened. We know Thomas More. We talked about him last week. Thomas More was also a high-ranking and Archbishop of Canterbury in England at the time of Henry VIII. Also, he refused to agree on his legality of his divorce and to be against his conscience, and he paid for it his head, which was hanged on the wall of his castle, or the fence of his castle for a month. We know that Galileo Galilei almost lost his life, but he recanted, and his theory that the earth is rotating and so on, and he stayed at home at rest till he died. So he saved himself from burning alive. One of the victims also is Michael Servetus. Michael Servetus grew up in and studied in Spain and North Africa, in Tunisia and so on, and in the Masajid, and of course he absorbed some of the Muslim ideas. And he wrote a book about the error of Trinity. And he's a doctor, he's a scientist. He was the one who carried the ideas of Ibn Nafis to Italy. And there William Harvey was studying in Italy, and he, after a couple of hundred years, and he fell on the, or a hundred year probably, on the books of Servetus, and he came up. Nowadays we know William Harvey is the discoverer of the blood circulation. Servetus, Michael Servetus, by caught not by the church, the Catholic Church, by the Protestant Church, by Calvin himself. And he was also burned alive for being a heretic. He paid his life. Nowadays, we know many, many movements in the 20th century, 21st century, from China and Tiananmen Square and all these dissident and so on. Of course, here we call them freedom fighters. In their own country, they are called heretics and traitors and witches and terrorists and you name it. Depends on your vantage point. And we know many examples who prevailed, like Nelson Mandela. He was like a thrown in the eye of apartheid in South Africa. And he was prisoned 21 years in solitary confinement. But with the consciousness of the world and the advancement of the United Nations, and so we know that they supported him and he prevailed. And the apartheid system was dismantled and he became a president. So this is a successful story. The same thing, Martin Luther King. He lost his life, but we know his ideas and civil liberties and so on helped to bring equality to all people. We know Gandhi also, he was an example of a man of conscience and helped in the independence of India. Of course, the books are full of people who stood up and faced injustices and so on. On the other hand, there are many people who stand up and create trouble, and their causes are just to create troubles, and those are not considered what we're talking about. So we hope ourselves to be very conscientious people and have always an awakened conscience, have this an-nafs al-lawwama, which judge us every day of what we have done right, what we have done wrong, and to erect the wrong. And we know the definition of the Muslim, he is the one who others are safe from his hand and tongue, and do nothing but good, enjoining good and forbidding evil. This is what the Muslims should be. And of course, as we have said, this awakened conscience is a state of taqwa. And we need to remember that all our ibadah, they are not mechanical movement. They are not rituals. They are not meaningless recitation or reading or bending and so on. All of these are techniques and procedures to increase and awaken your conscience to be God-fearing. In all your 24 hours of the day, it's not only on Sunday. You have to be God-fearing every minute of the day and night. And when you feel the presence of God, you cannot, and you have this love to God, beside the fear of God, and knowing that every breath you take is a gift from God, and He can't take you away any second, then I am very assured that you never can do anything wrong. You will be always a source of goodness and happiness and peace and security to everyone. We Muslim, we love everyone. We love humanity. We love goodness to come to everyone. We pray for everyone to have hidayah and to know God and to know the path of God. So inshallah, we will tackle some other issues or freedoms of the civil liberties, like the freedom of speech, freedom of expression, freedom of press, freedom of belief, and all of this in some detail. May Allah bless you all. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.